The following production comes from the imagination of Matthew Allen, where the best song's not the single and the bonus tracks don't count. We gonna be cursing, y'all. Listener's discretion is advised.
This is what happens when an unstoppable force meets an immovable object.
Good morning or evening, friends. It's your friendly announcer, Mr. Matthew Allen, the well-dressed headphone addict, coming at you live and in living color from Brooklyn, New York. Welcome to episode 5 of Get Off the Fence, the premier music debate podcast. I'd like to welcome my very esteemed guest today, Mr. Eric Black. Thank you very much for coming, Eric.
No, thank you for the invite. I'm honored to be here.
Excellent, excellent. Why don't you tell the good people what you do and your criteria? What do you be working on?
Oh man, I have a music website, ebforprez.com. Also co-host of the Soul Savinus radio show every Thursday on Studio W Buzz. I am just an avid listener and appreciatee of music, specifically R&B, but all music. I'm a music head. It's what I do. It's what I've been doing. It's something that tried to run for a while, but I'm here.
That's dope, man. Why don't you give the people the website URL? Give them the website.
Yes, it's www.eb4prez.com, and that is EB4PREZ.
Is that a play on the famous Eric B. and Rakim song?
It is. I'm a young guy. I'm born in 86, and so my mother is of that generation, the early hip-hop generation. And when I was younger, that's what she used to sing. You know, her thing was No Tricks in 86, It's Time to Build.
No Tricks in 86, It's Time to Build.
Like, that was for me, and that was, you know, you're Eric B. This is who you got to live up to. And I was like, okay.
That's the year that song came out, too.
Yeah.
My Melody with Eric B. for President on the B-side. Yeah. So, yeah, mm-hmm. You were definitely born into the hip-hop thing. That's the beginning of the golden era.
Right. Very beginning.
Mm-hmm. I remember that was also the same year that Raising Hell came out.
Mm.
And, man, I remember seeing Run DMC do Rock With a Sway with Aerosmith on MTV. Man. That was mind blowing. My mom beat my ass though because I scratched her turntable.
Oh, you can't do that.
No, because you see all I see is Jam Master Jay doing the scratching, and so I figure, oh, I can do that too. So one night, her and my dad were like listening to something. They're probably listening to like some like slow jams or whatever. It was probably mm-hmm. like I'll Be Dreaming, you know, one of those things. And I just went and my mom. Matthew Christopher. It's like, once you hear the middle name.
Oh, yeah, it's over.
It's over.
It's over.
I still prefer that memory than, like, trying to break dance, though.
Ugh.
I remember 86 is also the year, I think. No, 86 is when Breakin' 2 Electric Boogaloo came out. Because
mm-hmm.
Breakin' came out before that. And I used to watch the guys put the cardboard down and break dance. I try to do that so much. Man,
that sounds painful.
I made a fool out of myself. You know, they do. They bounce around on their back and they do those. I ruined a lot of shirts.
Oh man.
All right, so let's get right into the podcast. Today is episode 5. Quincy, as in Quincy Delight Jones Jr., a producer, artist, trumpet player, composer, arranger, conductor, media mogul, and all-around American legend. It would take a whole episode to discuss his contributions to music and black culture alone, so I'll just drop a couple of footnotes. Here are some of the people that he's worked with and championed and produced and arranged for. Frank Sinatra and Count Basie, Ray Charles, Lena Horne, the Brothers Johnson. He's done over 33 film and television scores, and of course, the multi-platinum Michael Jackson trilogy of Off the Wall, Thriller, and Bad. But today, it's all about Quincy, the solo artist. So we're going to try to debate which Quincy Jones solo album is the best of his classic 1980s solo projects, 1981's The Dude versus 1989's Back on the Block. And my esteemed guest, Eric, is Team The Dude, and I'm Team Back on the Block. So we're going to get right into this joint. Category number one, bookends. We are going to be judging the best opening track and best closing track of our respective albums. Eric, you have the floor. What is the opening track of The Dude?
I Know Karita. That is...
That's where you are.
Exactly. It is my favorite thing about any Quincy Jones production is always just the sheer musicianship and the power of his work and the people that he chooses to work with. So that's the opening track for The Dude.
Yes, yes, indeed. I think that's a dope opening track. I Know Karita is a cover, though.
Mm-hmm.
So Quincy was Quincy's always been notorious for finding gems that other people did, and there's someone Back on the Block too what we'll get into, but there is an English singer, his name is Chaz Jankel.
Yeah.
And he did the song the year before. I mean, the arrangement is virtually unchanged. It's just that Quincy used his notorious A-team to record this particular version. So it sounds super crisp and not that airy, hollow sort of production that happened a lot in the early 80s.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, still not quite as... I mean, it's a... All right. I always have to do this disclaimer. Neither one of us actually hates the opposing album. I always have to put that out there.
No.
I love I Know Karita. I remember the first time I heard it. It was when I heard The Dude in its entirety. But I also remember when I heard Sticks and Stones May Break Your Bones, But You Ain't Never Felt the Wrath of Quincy Jones, Heart to the Core, and Entrepreneur. Yo, okay. So let me tell you something. For all you listeners out there, you know that I don't like album intros. You know that I don't like album skits and interludes. Totally don't like them, with very few exceptions. But, man, the way that the prologue of Q's rap comes in and then segues into Back on the Block, man, it just really sets the tone for what you're about to hear. You know, and with QD3's rhyme, and then Quincy comes in.
I've been away for a long time. Now, I'm not only back, but I'm here to rhyme. So bust the move as I include that I'm back on the block portraying the dude.
Have you ever watched the documentary Listen Up by the lives of Quincy Jones? You actually see him, like, recording that part. And he actually does the part that QD3 does. QD3, of course, Quincy's son. And he's like, Sticks and Stones Ain't Break Your Bones, But You Ain't Never Have, you know. And he's like, it's getting raggedy, but I'll get it. But I'm glad that he decided, let him do it, and I'll just do those little tiny parts right there. When the song Back on the Block comes on, yo, the thing about Quincy, I just love, and we'll talk about this more, I love how he amalgamates all these different cultures and different ways and different types of black music into his albums and into his process, and he does it subtly a lot. And this, he really put it in the forefront in terms of, like, I'm gonna combine these African sort of chants with rapping, and, you know, it just went off really, really dope. And you know, what can I say about the rappers on here?
Okay, I mean, he did, you know, pull out the arsenal of, you know, all of the hottest rappers. Mm-hmm. And I guess it was kind of groundbreaking for Quincy Jones to even be venturing into rap, and for him to do so in that year, 89. Mm-hmm. And to have the support of, yeah, okay. It's still not better than I Know Karita.
Why?
Well, because it's not fair, you know. No. I Know Karita, it didn't have, like, there was no prologue. Nothing set it up. It just happened.
But sometimes that's what makes. Sometimes I personally prefer that way. That's why I like the prelude so long, because it's one of the few times it really sets the tone. But you actually, I know Carita had the advantage because that was back in the time where you couldn't rely on prologues and intros and all this other stuff that you have to like set up to make this grand statement, and it always ends up being like a disappointment at the end. So the fact that he just came in with the, you know, that little, you know, it's like the wind. That was kind of like an interlude in and of itself. You know, they had to be creative.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I know Carita is dope. But Back on the Block, man, I just love Kumo D's. He was the anchor. An everlasting omnipresence is my present state of being. Seeing the unpleasant sight of righteous souls look like peasants. The mind stunts growth and adolescence. Yo, he killed that. That's K-I-L-T. By the way, not killed. He killed it. You know, like the Scottish people that wear the... Sorry, I had to put that out there. All right, let's talk about... you got the thing about opening and closing tracks is that they set the tone for the record. How does I Know Carita set the tone for the dude?
In my opinion, it... So when the song, by the end of the song, and you know, you have Patty Austin on background.
Yeah.
And she was, for all intents and purposes, I still say she's like the most featured vocalist on that project.
Yeah, absolutely.
Because she's everywhere. It was jazzy. It was jazzy in a way that Quincy, you know, his roots in jazz. It made you feel like this is something that I have not heard. This is something that I'm not hearing right now. This is something that's not on radio. This is something that nor the producer is doing. It set the tone in that way that you knew you were in for, like you said, it was a remake. But it didn't have that same, the original version didn't have that, that bling, you know.
Yeah.
It lacked everything that everything that Quincy did to make it special, the original lacked. So you knew that no matter what you were hearing, you were in for something special. There was a classic somewhere in there. That's how it set the tone for me.
Mm-hmm. And that's great. And especially and particularly when you go from song one to song two.
Mm.
And the transition that it takes, you know, it goes right into that, you know, because, you know, there's lots of guitar, like there's really crisp guitars in I Know Carita that go right into that, like, crisp jangle into the title track. With that being said, I just love, once again, with transitions, with Back on the Block ends, the song Back on the Block ends, you hear, I contend that rap is here to stay. Next thing you know, you hear that hard beat, you know, from I Don't Go For That. And it just goes right into it. I was like, okay. So, yeah, you think that this is going to be, you know, a bunch of rappers and things like that. But, no, I have way more to offer than that. I have way more to offer than that. And that's when it gets right into the most featured singer on my album, which is Miss Syeda Garrett. And we'll talk more about her later on. Tell me about the closing track of The Dude.
Closing track on The Dude. Turn on the action.
Yo.
Closing.
I'm in trouble.
Closing track. Well, I don't know. Closing track, once again, you know, Patty Austin is magical. And it's Rod Temperton. I mean.
Oh.
It
don't even get me started on Rod.
Like. There are very few people that I would say I would give that. Like, I would say there's Rod Temperton.
Mm-hmm.
There's Ashford and Simpson.
Mm-hmm.
And there is probably Tom Bell. Like, that. There's, like, this super team of songwriters, and Rod Temperton is the one. I think a lot of... Even what we listen to today is still influenced by Rod Temperton.
Oh, absolutely. And Rod always does his homework. You know, I think that Rod's treatment with Quincy and Michael Jackson also, the whole idea of the sort of short note staccato style singing that Michael did on Off the Wall, the title track Off the Wall in particularly, you know, I think that really informed a lot. I mean, you go to like Beyonce's No, that, you know, that's got that sort of like beat riding the way that it was. And, you know, Rod, like you say, he did his homework and he would listen to artists and he would really hone in on them. I mean, another great example of how Rod meshes well with an artist is Baby Come To Me, which is a Patty Austin solo joint. And man, it doesn't sound like anything else he had written at the time, but it still sounds like a Rod song, like subtly. And yeah, when you get them two together, it's dope, you know. And then of course the song is about one of my favorite subjects in the world, which is lovemaking.
Hey.
But he does it so classy.
Right. Yeah, I mean, yeah, it is. It's very classy. But now that I think about it, a lot of his songs are like that. It's classy lovemaking. That's his category. That's his thing. Satin sheets. Temperton is what I'll refer to him as from now on, from this day forward.
Yeah, like Lady in My Life is another one like that. Man. Yeah. Star of a Story, dude. Goes on, but this is about Quincy, not about Rod. But we can't escape because Rod wrote the closing track on my album too.
See, and that is the ultimate.
Oh yeah,
that's Satin Sheet.
That's the killer. Yeah, he didn't do too many of them in terms of like those slow jam bedroom joints, but when he did, man, oh man! And so what I'm talking about is The Secret Garden, and. I just love the how Quincy put those voices together and made it work. Because his original idea for Secret Garden was Barry White was going to still be on it one way or another, but he wanted Michael Jackson, Lana Richie, and Stevie Wonder to sing the verses. This is before Saida and Elle contributed their writing portion, of course. All he had was Rod's demo. And because of, you know, scheduling restraints and contract stuff, label stuff, the three of them were not able to be on it. So he got his, you know, his boy, Al B. Shore, who won that songwriting contest for Night and Day that Quincy was judging a year or two before. He's actually Al B. Shore's son's godfather. That's why his name is Quincy. And then, of course, he goes to his old faithful, Mr. James Ingram, and then L. I mean, L's a poor man's Michael Jackson, I suppose.
Ouch.
No, I don't want to shortchange L.
Oh,
because L is a really dope singer and a really great songwriter. I mean, the DeBarge was certainly the poor man's Jackson 5. But it's also a little unfair. But
just a little bit.
Yeah,
just a little bit.
That much.
Yeah.
But man, The Secret Garden, just the way it comes out. I've never heard Albie sound that confident, that, you know, just dense in terms of like his singing. Like he really sung from his diaphragm on that one.
I wanna read your mind. Know your deepest feelings. I wanna make it right for you. Baby, show me. Let me share the mystery. Oh, come on, come on, come on, come on. Listen to your heart tonight.
You're gonna hear a lot of kilts today.
Kilt. With a T.
Yes. But it's a beautiful, beautiful record. And just that, if you think I am gonna take care of you, I just, show you right. Oh, yeah. So dope. So dope. It's tough, though. I mean, Turn the Action is such a bright, happy thing. And then you have Secret Garden, which is just the antithesis of that.
Yeah.
It's hard to judge. But I'm gonna.
Of course you will.
And of course, the funny thing about that is, for me, it's totally the other side of the coin, because the preceding song of The Secret Garden is another interlude.
See?
Yeah, I'm not, yeah.
See?
Definitely coming from behind on that one. Just totally making all my proclamations previously just pale in comparison. Totally seem like a hypocrite now. But, yeah. And then, of course, yours, I mean, Turning Action, Velas is the song that...
Yeah, and Velas is, come on, like... That song is one of the most beautiful that I've ever heard. And then we get the Jodeci sample. Come on, everybody mm-hmm. was trying to get on up in like 98, you know. Everybody was like, oh, this is Hyde. And it's like, no, but it's because of Velas. That's why.
What song, this is totally embarrassing. What song does Jodeci sample Velas for?
Oh, they gotta get on up.
Yeah. You're
yeah, you know.
Shit, it sounds so good to me. You gotta get on up. Get on.
How did I, yo, because I blow people's mind with, like, you know, this is sampled from such and such. I totally didn't know that.
Yeah, that is my favorite. I think that made me love Velas even more. Like, once that blew up and I was like, oh, you know what? Like, because, you know, on the dude, you know, Velas is all instrumental.
Yeah.
So, and I think, no, there's one version I've heard of it that is not, version that came out maybe like 3 years ago, Brandon Williams and Nadia Washington. But it's all instrumental. So I guess it could be considered a prelude for
a long ass prelude.
Yeah, a very long prelude.
Okay, just really quick, put you on the spot. Who's a better harmonica player, Toots or Stevie?
Stevie.
Okay, good. just wanted to make sure. All right, let's go to category number 2, Higher Highs, the best single releases. I'll start on this one.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so the single releases for Back on the Block were I'll Be Good to You, The Secret Garden, and this is in chronological order of which they were released. I'll Be Good to You, The Secret Garden, Tomorrow, and I Can't Go for That. So just back to back to back. So I'll Be Good to You, once again, is another cover. Quincy was really starting to, like, show, like, his propensity for covering tracks and doing really good, like, remakes of stuff. But then he started to remake his own stuff. Once he got to The Dude, actually, the title track is, like, it takes the lyrics from a soundtrack called Dollars. And, like, the theme of Dollars, like, the rap in that is actually from that soundtrack from, like, 1973 or 4. And so by the time he gets Back on the Block, he totally puts it in overdrive. I mean, even Back on the Block itself samples Quincy because it samples that Ironside. So with I'll Be Good to You, it's a totally meta sort of reference because of the Brothers Johnson thing. It was written and recorded by the Brothers Johnson originally on their debut album, Looking for Number One. It was their big breakout hit as a duo. But he put Ray Charles and Chaka Khan on that track. I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, the only thing missing from that is someone saying, DJ Khaled! Because who else could put, you know, and I'll talk about this later too, who else can get people of that much clout on one track? And this is not like some Justin Bieber and Chance the Rapper together with Frank Ocean and Quavo and whatever.
No, I'll keep it.
You know, this is Ray Charles and Chaka Khan, legitimate legends who are still very much in, you know, fine form. Then you get The Secret Garden, which you already spoke about. You know, a lot of babies born to that song. A lot of babies will be born to that song. Then we get to Tomorrow. Okay. Speaking of babies, this is a song I sing to my son at night sometimes, or I've sung it to him a couple times. And man, I just gotta give a shout out to Tevin Campbell. This is when we first meet Tevin Campbell for the first time in terms of like being introduced to the world. When he just comes in and that voice is so pure, he had to be what, 9 or 10?
Yeah, I think 10.
Yeah, like 10 mm-hmm. when he recorded that. And he has such control of his voice. It's really, and he knows his voice. And you know he knows how to use it and he knows how to control it. And that's what makes Tomorrow such a dope, dope record.
And we try, we get by to a home and a place. All we need is belief and a smile on our face. We can go anywhere we want, any road we decide to take. And we're never, never, never too far from tomorrow today.
And then I can't go for that. You know, I can't lie. I can take or leave that one. I personally could have chosen any. I would have rather had One Man Woman be a single than I Can't Go for That. But the whole, like I said, the listen, like that, listen up, that became like the mantra and the title for the Quincy Jones documentary about Back on the Block, about his life. So, you know, that has some significance, but certainly the weakest of the three. I mean, I'll Be Good to You, Secret Garden, Tomorrow, you know, it's dope, you know. But I have to say, it is curious that he didn't use, you know, Back on the Block as a single, considering the whole rappers and jazz amalgamation together. That is kind of curious to me.
I've wondered that before. It would seem that would have been the single, and had that been a single, just thinking about what it would have done at the time for hip hop, not only hip hop but jazz as well. You know, that fusion of the two. I'm not sure why it wasn't a single.
Yeah, I know that they did it on, I think, Arsenio or something, and Ice-T came out and Quincy was there, and it was one of those like late night talk shows or whatever it was, mm-hmm. but. Yeah, now that I'm really thinking about it, I'm like, it's strange that he didn't make that a single, or A&M didn't make that a single. But there's another funny story about Quincy's, you know, gives you no shortage of interesting stories. So in his autobiography, he lets some people have, like, testimonials in his autobiography. One of them is Melly Mel, and he talks about how, you know, he was in jail or whatever on some drug stuff. He gets out of jail and he goes back home to the Bronx, and some dude's like, yo, Quincy Jones is looking for you. I don't know if you've ever been to the Bronx, but in particularly where Melly Mel and Flash and all those guys hang out. But can you just imagine like a long stretch limousine pulling up on Grand Concourse or somewhere like that, and then a window just goes down and you see a single hand say, come here. And it's like, is Melly Mel home yet? It's like, no. It's like, well, tell him. And he gives him a card. Tell him to call me when he gets this. And then it just speeds off. Man. And next thing you know, Melly Mel's at a payphone. Like, Quincy's like, yo, I got a first class ticket for you to come to my house in LA. I need you to get on the plane today. And he's like, okay. And then Melly Mel's like, dude, I just got out of jail and he's asked me to come to his house. He's got jewelry and stuff all over the place. He's not afraid I'm going to steal anything. But he talked about how Quincy said, yo, I'm doing this song and I need you. Like, something about your words, your voice, I need that for this. And, you know, Quincy, he never, you know, had hang-ups about hiring certain people. He really did, you know, I need this person, and then boom.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what made him so dope, or that was what makes him so dope. So, yeah. So let's get to the singles from The Dude.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, we talked about I Know Carita.
Yeah, dope, dope record.
And then the next single you have Just Once. Mm-hmm. You have James
the ultimate tribute. Sorry to interrupt, but that's the ultimate tribute to Lay's potato chips.
Yeah. Just Once.
They They really, Quincy really missed the boat. All right, go ahead.
You just got somebody at Lay's fired.
Go ahead.
You got James Ingram, and you have Patty Austin again on background vocals. Mm-hmm. It became, like I said, with I Know Karita, how it kind of set the tone for an album. Like, you knew you're going to hear something special, like some classic stuff. Mm-hmm. Just Once was... it's like one of those songs. It was like a Cardi B before Cardi B was Cardi B. You know, a song you could not get away from. Like, You know, I'm pretty sure people got tired of hearing Just Once because That's how much of an impact it made. And then you had 100 Ways. I mean, 100 Ways is still like, I put that on today. Mm-hmm. And I'm still, you know, the compliment.
Yeah.
What you do.
He has RIP to James
Ingram. Yeah, RIP.
Man, he had such a distinct voice.
So distinct. So distinct. And, I mean, for him to be on two of the three singles, mm-hmm. you know.
That's a good look for him.
It's a very good look for him because, like I said, you know, Patty's all throughout the album. You would think that, you know, one of her songs, her solo songs, or something she was lead on, mm-hmm. would have been chosen as a single, but it was all about James Ingram.
And I have to give them a little bit of credit for this, but I also have to give a little shade, too, once again with the single selection thing. So it was a great look for James because he actually won a Grammy behind, I think, Just Once. And he was nominated for 3 Grammys total. Hmm. And this was like his first time singing on a record ever. Mm-hmm. But like number one, there's no Patty featured songs that became singles. And number two, there were 4 Rod Temerton contributions on the dude, and not one of them were singles.
This is true.
Of them. And then you have Bet You Couldn't Hurt Me. How do you not make that a single?
I'm saying.
Seriously.
It's been my only beef. That song has not been a single.
Yeah. Stevie really came through with that synth part. Anytime I hear shit like that, I'm like, yo, he should have just kept that for himself. Mm. Every now and again, I'll hear something by an artist that they wrote. I'm like, damn. Like, I'll give you a perfect example. Miguel. Miguel, dope singer, really talented songwriter also. He worked with this chick, this British singer named Jessie Ware, and he wrote a single with her called Kind of Sometimes Maybe, and it's such a lush, sexy song, and I'm like, damn, like, yo, he would have killed it. Like, oh, like, I know you're being generous, I know writing is where the money is, but, like, come on.
Yeah, you gotta make your money.
Yeah, so, yeah, I have beef with that. But, another funny story about James Ingram, his voice is the demo track of Just Once, which mm-hmm. is how he got on the album in the first place. He was a keyboard player in Ray Charles's band. That was his main job, was to be a keyboard player, and he just sang on demos for extra money. So when Quincy heard the demo, he says, whoever's singing on that, I need him in here. So when he called James, like, you want me to play? He's like, no, I want you to sing. He's like, but I'm not a singer. He's like, is that you on the demo? Yeah. Then you're a singer. Can you imagine we came that close to not ever hearing James Ingram sing on record?
I mean, but for James Ingram to say that I'm not a singer, like, his voice is, it's one of the best.
Yeah.
So for him not to think so, I mean, I guess at the time, you know.
He was thinking about it from, like, a marketing standpoint, the way that people think about it now. Like, the whole, like, my voice is so gruff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And, you know, raspy. Like, that's not what's happening on the radio right now. Mm-hmm. And he was thinking about it from that perspective. But it took Quincy to say, no, that's why I like it. And, you know, the rest is history. Just once, can we find a way to finally make it right? Whoa, make the magic last for more than just one night. Oh, we could break through it if we could just get to it just once.
So we got on the dude, we got James Ingram, first time that we're meeting him, essentially.
Yeah.
And then on Back to the Block, we got Tevin Campbell. So it's got to be Tevin Campbell against James Ingram.
I really want to say Tevin Campbell just because it's my argument.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, man, James's voice is just so otherworldly. But at the same time, Tevin Campbell's also not currently deceased. So maybe I'll true. just that was too soon.
That was.
I might have to edit that one out. Anytime I say I have to edit that one out, that's my cue to make it, I'm sure I say, don't edit that.
Don't edit that.
Keep that in there. All right, this is one of my favorite parts of the podcast, and this can go real sideways. We're having a great time right now, but we'll see if that lasts, because we're at category 3, which is lower lows. In this category, we each have to pick the weakest song on the opposing album, a song that we think, whether it's because there's nothing as weak on our own albums or because it just doesn't fit in our opinion. I'll let you go first, Derek. What would you take off, or what would you think is the lowest point of Back on the Block? And I respectfully say, watch your mouth.
Listen, we be doing it.
No! No!
We be doing
no!
it.
No! No!
We be doing it.
I knew it! Oh, no! No! I can't go for that was right there.
No.
I cannot. No.
We be doing it.
Why? How, Sway?
Oh, no.
Okay, please, I want to hear this. Okay, go ahead.
Now I'm nervous.
Okay, go ahead. Sorry. The floor is yours.
To me, and don't ever let anybody hear this. He set up what I said.
Yeah. All right, go ahead. This is a safe place. This is a safe place.
I hate Syeda Garrett.
You hate Syeda Garrett.
I have only ever liked Syeda Garrett on one song, and it's not even her song. And yeah, I can't go for that.
But why we be doing it though?
I mean, okay, so you got Take Six, Sarah Vaughan.
Yeah.
To me, it seems like a forced song. Like it doesn't feel even like Back on the Block. Quincy with the rappers did not seem forced at the time for whatever reason to me.
Yeah.
It just felt, you know, like the natural progression of things.
Yeah.
We be doing it. It just felt like, oh, okay, let's throw them all on this song. And Syeda, try your best to sound good. I don't know how that works, but, do what you can.
Ah!
you know, it's like, oh, okay, we're going to need, call Tech 6. Yeah, they do the, and then, oh, we need somebody else. Sarah Vaughan. It's like, what? It to me, it doesn't make sense.
Yeah, just like Sarah Vaughan was just sitting around with nothing to do. Like, put the hot dog down.
I need you to come sing background for Syeda Garrett.
Yo, this is
Sarah Vaughan singing background for Syeda Garrett.
I wish you guys could see my face right now.
This dude
is hilarious.
I
mean this in a good and a bad.
No, to me, it's the weakest song on the album. Like, if it was completely left off, I would have been fine. I might have said that Back on the Block was a better album.
Okay. All right. In the words of Sam Jackson in Pulp Fiction. Well, allow me to retort. I dreaded that you might say that. That was the one song I was not prepared for you to say. That was the. I was literally getting off the train last night from work. It was late. And I was saying, God, please don't let him say this one.
Really?
Because, actually, no. I was of two minds because, number one, if he says this song, I'm going to go crazy. But at the same time, it's going to make the show great because I'm going to go crazy. Because I'm a TV guy, you know, so I'm like, I'm thinking like, yo, that's going to be super entertaining. But at the same time, we're like, no, I'm going to bang my head against a wall.
Syd Garrett's fault.
All right. But here's my thing. We be doing it. This whole the idea of the acapella thing. I literally didn't know that was an acapella song till late, even though they say acapella party all throughout it. But, you know, when you're a kid, you know, because I was seven when that album came out. So it took a while for me to really, because I'm just thinking about the groove of the song. I'm not thinking about the words. Mm-hmm. But it's not just Syd Garrett. And you get Take Six, Syeda, you get Sarah Vaughan, and you have Ella Fitzgerald and Al Jarreau, Bobby McFerrin.
Mm-hmm. Oh, we can jam in the human.
You know, like I said, this is a who's who of people. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like I said, this is like DJ Khaled except without, you know, Assad.
Syd Garrett is the Assad. She is. She is Assad. Assad is she. That's just how I feel. I mean.
Okay.
And, you know, yeah, he has a who's who of classic musicians on this song, but it still, for me, fell flat. And now that I think about it, maybe it being a cappella is part of the reason.
So you think that if there was a track on it, it would sound better? Or do you think that?
I think, okay, yeah. So there are two things you could do to make it a little better.
I know getting rid of Syeda is one of them.
Oh, yeah, that's like
so
a
what's
big,
the other one?
Yeah, I would have had a track out, but I guess that would have mean I would have gotten rid of Take Six.
Mm-hmm. And nobody knows Take Six at this point.
Like, yeah.
Like, this is like Take Six's coming out party. Like, this is the same year. This is 1989, so debut album came out the following year. This is the first time anyone's hearing them. It's on this album, and then they're also on Fight the Power soundtrack. They have a song called Don't Shoot on there. But other than that, no one knows who Take Six is. I mean, we know in hindsight that they're a big
right.
deal. But, oh, I'm having palpitations.
I'm just
right
saying,
now.
It's the weakest song on the album.
Okay. All right. So, all right, it's my turn.
Oh, boy.
All right. This is probably not going to be as damning. The weakest song on The Dude is The Dude.
What?
Yes.
The Dude.
The title track. Track number 2.
That is the weakest song?
That's the weakest song on that.
How, Sway?
Okay.
How?
Okay. It's the weakest song on that. Because you have to, because it's, for one thing, it's process of elimination. I'm definitely not getting rid of any of the temper. Well, I shouldn't say that because Rod co-wrote this too. But I'm not. All the solo Rod Temperton joints, which is Turn on the Action, Something Special, and Razzmatazz.
Mm-hmm.
Not getting rid of those. Can't get rid of any of the any of the main James Ingram songs, which is Just Once and 100 Ways. Can't get rid of Velas because it's instrumental, quite frankly, it's too easy to get rid of an instrumental on an album of all whatever. Mm-hmm. Definitely not getting rid of I Know Carita. So, and then, of course, the premise of The Dude is just super silly. Like, it's like, if you guys are listening to this, go and look at the album cover of The Dude. It's this statue that Quincy bought in, I can't remember what the country it was, but it was, I think him and Harry Mancini were doing something, and he saw this statue, and for some reason, Quincy said the statue was like, yo, take me home with you. Make me an album. Make me a tune. That's what Quincy's words. And just the whole like premise, don't you go messing with his walking stick, rap dude. I was like, that's just like, it really brings down the like the lyrical maturity of the dude, the album. Just like he is a player because it's in his blood. Ain't nobody like, you know. It's just, it's so juvenile. Just the lyric is mad juvenile to me. I mean, this, the track is dope. I mean, you got JR on there, JR Robinson on drums. You got Thunder Thumbs Johnson on bass, and it also pains because MJ's on this. This is,
yeah,
MJ and Patty Austin are doing backgrounds on this one song. But no, just lyrically, it's not
hold up. Stevie.
Yeah, and Stevie's solo is in there too. I mean, oh, but I got to do it, man. Something's got to go. And
I feel like that was retaliation.
Oh, you think I didn't have one until you just said that? Is that what you're
saying? I feel
like I was
like,
just gonna wing it.
Yeah, I feel like, you know.
No.
Oh man.
No, the dude is the weakest song on the dude. Definitely.
Wow.
Most definitely. If you guys don't agree, please feel free to comment. I mean, everybody that's listening to this, of course, we're on Mixcloud right now. Please go to the comment section. Tell me, what is the weakest song on The Dude and what is the weakest song on Black and the Block? Which ones would you take off? I would love to hear your opinions on this because apparently we're both out of our minds. It's early in the morning. Well, it's early. Well, it's like almost 11 o'clock, which is early for a Saturday. But yeah, just put it out there. But no, The Dude's got to go. I don't even know if I want to go on now. Like now. All right, let's get to category four, lyrically speaking. This is when we talk about all the great and impactful lyrics on each other's album. Eric, why don't you kick this one off?
Okay, so 100 Ways.
Yeah.
If it's violins she wants, let them play. That to me, I could say that on that entire album, most people would probably say that that is one of the most beautifully written songs on the album. But my favorite is Bet You Wouldn't Hurt Me. Mm. I think it was a different type of song, meaning, you know, we were used to hearing these, you know, this song with a quote-unquote sassy woman speaking her mind, you know, yeah, letting men know how she feels. But Patty did this thing where it was kind of a, you know, I'm begging you to love me. I am pleading, you know, don't love me. I mean, don't leave me. Mm-hmm. Love me. If you cared, you know, playing on this man's emotional well-being, you know, if you cared, you wouldn't hurt me.
Though some days the blues was our parade, still we marched through all the tears we made. Now I find it wasn't no game of charades that you played.
For me, that was very impactful.
Yeah. There's a lot of dope lyricism on The Dude. Like, I'm not even gonna like try to, like I said, I'm not gonna try to like, with the exception of The Dude, of course. the song, yeah, the lyrics, nuh-uh.
But it fit the album cover.
It fit the album cover, yeah, for what it was. But let's not go to the past here. But tell me more about like we were talking a lot about Turn On the Action. Like, tell me a little bit more about the lyrics on that. Like I said, it's just a classy way to talk about sex.
We already said it's because of Rod Temperton and, you know, the way he has with crafting sex. So it's not sex. It's lovemaking.
Mm-hmm.
Even when it's supposed to be sex, it's lovemaking for him. So, and my favorite thing about the song is actually the chorus, and it's because of the way that it's being sung, like the mm-hmm. turn on the it mm-hmm. it kind of it didn't let me forget that it was sex, you mm-hmm. know. If everything else told me that this was lovemaking, the way that was saying it was like a, oh, okay, we turning on some action.
Mm-hmm.
I wouldn't say well, I don't know. I don't know if it was intentional on his part. I don't know if it was intentional. I'm sure it was on Quincy, you know, with the way that Patty sang it. But
mm-hmm. she never overdoes it.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? She never just says, you know, I'm just going to sing this shit to make sure people know that I can sing.
Yeah, no. And that's probably one of my, I mean, off subject a little, this is one of my favorite things about Patty Austin, because she's never done that. She's always like, you know, I can sing, but I'm going to give the song exactly what it needs. I'm not going to give it too much, and I'm yeah. not going to, you know, come up short in any way.
So let's talk about the lyrics of from Back on the Block, the album. So I'm going to start off with Tomorrow. Man, I just love that. If we try, we can fly to a whole nother place. All we need is belief and a smile on our face. We can go anywhere we want, any road we decide to take, and we're never, ever, ever too far from tomorrow today. That is so deep. That's so deep and dope. And then you get to, man, let's just backtrack a little bit. I want to talk about the jazz corner of the world. I gotta talk about that. And just the way Kane set up all those musicians for Birdland. You know, a voice of choice used just like an instrument, so magnificent, I'm proud to present Divine Sassio, aka Sarah Vaughan, Honey Ron. He says, what kind of noise can a string bring, making a swing and sing things with a musical fling? To listen to this star, next up is odd, George Benson bringing the guitar. When he says, no one goes the mile like Miles Davis. Watch how he plays his trumpet and pump it just like a mechanic handles a tool. Here's the rebirth of the cool. Kane was like in his early 20s. What does he know about the birth of the cool and Miles Davis? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Like, just crazy.
I'm introducing a bop revolution in jazz that has bazans. He has one player using it. Ask who is he? First name Dizzy. Last name Gillespie. Now watch him get busy.
Yo. Kane is that guy, and just from a lyrical standpoint, and then and Kumo D on the title track, when he said, and I want to get these lyrics right, Kumo D was woke before woke was even a statement. I want to give him his props on being the anchor of that track, because like I said, Kane really did his thing, and so did Mel, Ice-T, you know. Ice-T is Ice-T, but
perfect way to say that.
it's lemonade. Read the sign.
And the Ice-T is Ice-T.
Yes, Ice-T is Ice-T. But I want to talk about just Kumo D's verse on Back on the Block, because there's a line, there's a lot about that song that's so dope. But before I talk about that, there is one line that I love from Ice-T on his, when he says, the dude is definitely back. What can I say? The man can roll with Ice-T or Michael J. And that really, that one little line is so simple, but it talks about the spectrum of Quincy's openness in terms of the people he collaborates with.
Mm-hmm.
So I got to put that out there. But just to talk about Kumo D's lyrics. All right, so he says,
my insight enables me to enlighten the weakest of minds, and I put him in flight as I transcend the ascend or descend, recreate, reincarnate, and reset the powerful spirits of our ancestors. For those that don't know how God blessed us, because man messed up, the media dressed up, lies perpetrated as truth, and it left us confused. But I've seen it all before, from Babylon to the Third World War.
That was the first verse other than Ice-T's, because Ice-T's was very easy to remember. But that was the second, the first significant verse of that song. Look, I love Ice-T. Shout out. I'm the hugest SVU fan.
I was about to say.
I literally watch that like it's the first time every time.
Yeah.
And
same.
I watch it forever. But,
we're talking about music, not acting.
Yeah, I know. I'm just saying I love Ice-T. And if he ever hears this, he might feel away, but, you know, he's
no, you didn't say anything. You just said Ice-T is Ice-T.
Yeah, Ice-T. Thank you. But what Kumo D said on that was so right on, and it's once again tapping into the way that black men and black women are treated in the United States and worldwide in terms of being disenfranchised despite the rich history of our ancestors and the first people on this earth. You know, like when people say, like, Us is the first movie that had a big opening weekend for a black woman as the lead.
Yeah,
like like people say that that's a big deal, but like, no, like, we built the pyramids.
Yeah,
that's a big deal. Like we, you know, innovated architecture and wealth and science and mathematics. That's a big deal. But it got to the point where, like I said, where he says, because man messed up in media, dressed up lies perpetrated as truths, and it left us confused. I've seen it all before, but from Babylon to the Third World War. He's saying that line is ill because he's saying it's been going on since creation, and it will go on even beyond this point because there's no Third World War yet. So when it does happen, it's still going to be there. So that's why I love that lyric more than anything. I mean, I can go on and on about lyrics, but I just wanted to talk about those two in particular because it's just super, super ill, super ill.
Yeah, so, I think even like you were talking about Tomorrow, lyrically, it's almost perfect. And to have a kid singing it, mm-hmm. it kind of like invoked this feeling of hope, like, you know, yeah, we gonna be all right, you know, before Kendrick, you know, we gonna be all right. But the dude, you hate the dude.
Yeah, I do. But go ahead, please.
I mean, the lyrics, it was silly, mm-hmm. but I felt like that's what they were going for.
I know that's what they were going for, and that's fine. But like I said, the lyrics aren't even like original. They're like they take from another Quincy song.
I got a PhD in how to make ends meet. I graduated from the college industry. Inflation in the nation don't bother me, 'cause I'm a scholar when it comes to the almighty dollar.
I got a PhD in how to make ends meet. Inflation in the nation don't bother me, 'cause I'm a scholar with a dollar, you can plainly see.
Yeah, but it's still Quincy's song.
Yeah. You can't steal from yourself, John Fogerty.
Out.
No, that's less on John Fogerty and more on the morons that sued him. But yeah, for those of you who don't know, John Fogerty, the former lead singer of Creedence Clearwater Revival, and I think in the 1980s he was taken to court because one of his solo records was very similar to a song from Creedence. The problem is that he wrote both of those songs himself, and how can you plagiarize yourself? So, yeah. little history nugget. let's bring this thing home. And once again, my esteemed guest, you will take place. This is category 5, the final category of the podcast, the X Factor. Tell me one thing, one special thing that we may or may not have already talked about that brings it all together, that makes the dude superior to Back on the Block.
The musicians.
Mm-hmm.
The musicians that he worked with. And, I mean, you got Stevie Wonder, Michael Jackson,
mm-hmm.
Herbie Hancock,
yeah,
Patty Austin, and we met James Ingram. I think that, to me, it was a soulful, it was like a big soulful ass party. Just mm-hmm. everybody, like, just imagining, you know, them in studio, like the fun that they were all having together. You know, everybody on their own, you know, a force to be reckoned with already. But then together, all of them together, I feel like that's what put it over the edge for me. It makes it the better album. Just the, and it wasn't like, as opposed to Back to the Block, where, you know, you have Syeda Garrett and and then you have, like, you know, the rappers with the jazz legends, you know, it's just like, oh yeah, it's this this hodgepodge of art and talent. On the dude, it was, you know, honestly, like,
so you're saying that the mixture of musicians and singers meshed better on the dude than it did on Back of the Block.
It meshed so much better, and this is 81, and they're all in their prime. Well, Michael hadn't yet reached his prime. He was on the cusp, but
I would say Bad Era Michael is his prime.
Yeah.
From an artistic standpoint.
Yeah. So it was just having those musicians and, you know, the vibe that they built together. That's what makes it the better album.
Mm-hmm. Very good. And that, it's funny because that's something that I wanted to touch on. Mm. But I have to say this because I feel like I have to represent here from all the slander. Syeda Garrett is the real MVP. Forget Kevin Durant's mom. Syeda Garrett, you the real MVP. Let me tell you why. Quincy Jones is notorious for his female feature artists on his records. They're the ones that stand out. All the female artists, these sister, beautiful black queen female artists, are always from the late 70s all the way up to Q's Juke Joint. He always has that one female artist that is the centerpiece in sounds and stuff like that. It was Chaka Khan, mm-hmm, and Valerie Simpson. Mm-hmm. And then you get to the dude, you have Patty Austin. Now, when you go to Q's Juke Joint, it's Tamia. Mm-hmm. With Back on the Block, it's Syeda Garrett. And she's not just singing. She's also writing songs. She's also directing. She directed the choir in Tomorrow. She is the vocal producer on Secret Garden. She wrote lyrics on The Secret Garden. She wrote the lyrics of Tomorrow. Tomorrow was an instrumental track on the Brothers Johnson's first album. The album is called Looking Out for Number One. Quincy produced it and arranged it. Quincy was also their manager. And on that album you have I'll Be Good to You, Lightning Licks and Thunder Thumbs, Land of Ladies, Get the Funk Out of My Face. And then you have this little short instrumental track called Tomorrow. Syeda was able to take that and then write those beautiful lyrics. Lyrically, her pen game is nuts. Syeda Garrett's pen game is insane in terms of being a songwriter. I mean, she got nominated for what? She's been nominated for what? 3 Academy Awards for Best Original Song?
Yeah.
And when you go back to, like, Man in the Mirror, just think about the... What is that for?
I hate that song.
Okay. Okay. All right. I'm going to come back to that in a minute. But you think about Man in the Mirror and you think about the lyric on that first verse. As I turned up the collar on my favorite winter coat, this wind is blowing my mind. I see the kids in the street without enough to eat. Who am I pretending not to see their needs? The fact that I turned the collar on my winter coat, ooh, this wind is blowing my mind. That stream of consciousness, like you're a person in, like, walking down the street. The stream of consciousness of that, it's putting you in real time. And then it goes back to being perspective. That is so ill and so progressive in terms of songwriting, in terms of lyricism. Okay. Man in the Mirror wasn't my favorite when it came out. I grew to love that song later in life. But hate, like the opposite of love, but the same energy, that's
a little more energy.
That's strong. I mean, come on, man. Quincy said that was the best song he'd heard in 10 years when Saeed gave him a demo for that. But at the same time, Quincy also did not want Smooth Criminal on Bad, too.
Okay, that's crazy. That is crazy. But, I mean, okay.
All right. We'll talk more about that offline. But I'm going to get into my X Factor.
Okay.
Okay, and this is my X Factor about Back on the Block. Back on the Block is in, and we saw this in the Quincy Jones, the Quincy documentary. It's the precursor for albums like To Pimp a Butterfly, and I'll explain why. Because the way it's set up, it's kind of like, oh, and the way it's talked about, it's like I'm going to get all the rappers of the new generation and all the great jazz legends of the old generation and put them together on one album. When that only happens for one song or two songs, technically, which is Jazz Corner of the World and Back on the Block, and then all these jazz legends do Birdland, the famous Weather Report song. So that's not really what the album is based on. The album is super versatile. It takes all of what Quincy had learned over the years, and it puts it in a pot, and it perfectly melds it. You take the African influences, you know, stuff you got, you hear on the Roots score, the stuff that you heard in Beautiful Black Girl from Mellow Madness, and, you know, all the polyrhythms from Don't Stop to Get Enough and that sort of thing. And then you have the rappers, you know, with the tradition of African griots, you know, the tradition of Gil Scott-Heron goes on and on. And then you have all these famous jazz heads. I mean, I'm just going to go down the line. He had Miles Davis, Sarah Vaughan, James Moody, you know, Errol Fitzgerald, George Benson, Dizzy Gillespie, Herbie Hancock, all these people up and down this album. And it just comes together great. And then you take all these new people, like Saeeda, like someone like Ian Prince, who was a songwriter, and then you put them together with all his regular standbys from his A-team, or the Killer Q Posse, which has been dubbed, of J.R. Robinson and Louis Johnson and James Ingram, Rod Temperton, Bruce Woodian, the unsung hero of all of this because he's the engineer, the pioneer of the Acousonic recording process, which Quincy used him for over 25 years of this innovative technology in which he's able to preserve the master recording until the very end when you're ready to put it down. So it sounds super crisp and you don't hear any wear on the tape. And you take that and you have Barry White, James Ingram, El DeBarge, I'll Be Sure on one song. And it worked. Quincy was clairvoyant. That's what makes Back on the Block so great. And it's what makes all of his albums great, his clairvoyance. He knew it. I was humbled to be able to interview him one time. And I asked him about this. How are you able to find these people? Because Quincy Dot only knows what to do with legends. He knows what to do with new people and make them legends. Not just with music. You take Michael Jackson. Everyone thought Michael Jackson was as famous as he was ever going to get by the time he got to The Wiz. Only Quincy was able to see more outside of Michael himself. James Ingram didn't even think he was going to be a singer. Will Smith, you know, was a rapper. Quincy saw he was going to be a big star with the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. That was Quincy. Patty Austin is Sarah Vaughan's goddaughter. Okay? You know, you go down like Tevin Campbell. He's 10 years old. 10-year-old Tevin Campbell. Who knew he was going to, you know what I'm saying? This little kid. And next thing you know, you hear Goodbye and Can We Talk and Do What You Want Me to Do and Look What We'd Have. Round and Round, You Know I'm Ready to Love You. Like, it, you just go down the, like, who knew? And he said, well, I can't explain it. I just see it before they see it. And that goes to clairvoyance. That's what makes this album so great. He had enough knowledge of his backing history, which is palpable and unfathomable and unmatched in modern music history, and was able to see the future because of it. Mm. He created that album like a jazz pianist does a solo. He took all the rules that he had to learn and knew it enough to know when and how to break them. And then you get someone like Kendrick Lamar and Terrace Martin and Thundercat and Fly Low and all these guys together, and they make an album like To Pimp a Butterfly, or Kanye getting with John Bryan and making an album like Late Registration. It just goes, or even Q-Tip having the foresight to use Ron Carter on the bass on Low End Theory album. It really paved the way for this great American innovation that is hip hop music, and taking it and saying, this is innovative, this is what we created, but it's not nothing new either. We've been doing this forever. But now you guys caught up to us. And that's what Quincy was. He was clairvoyant. He was clairvoyant, and he knew what would work. And because no one was going to, who else is going to do it? He was doing it already. Like I said, on Mellow Madness, he got, you know, speakers on the album. You know, he had Vincent Price do a rap on Thriller. You know what I'm saying? Quincy is clairvoyance, and he knows how to put the right people together, because he, as Terrace Martin in Ninth Wonder once said, realized the biggest ego in the room is the song. Mm. And you have to put your ego aside if you know that something, if the song needs something that you can't do, or something that you don't agree with. And that's what makes Quincy Quincy. And that's a wrap for episode 5 of Get Off the Fence Season 1, The Dude versus Back on the Block. Thank you all for listening, and thank you to Eric Black for being my very special guest for today's episode. This episode also marks the last of the relaunched archived episodes. From here on out, everybody, it's brand spanking new episodes just for you. I hope you stick around next Monday for a special debate on Mary J. Blige's My Life and What's the 411. In the meantime, let's have a little extra of today's episode. So, now, why don't you like Man in the Mirror again?
And it really just could be like overexposure.
Yeah. Which is fine. I mean, a lot of Michael's music.
Yeah. But I guess that's the difference. A lot of his music is like, it's overexposure, but I still like the songs. Mm-hmm. I can think of very few Michael Jackson songs that I absolutely don't like. And
very few.
And Man in the Mirror is like my one. It makes my skin crawl. If we're being honest here, it makes my skin crawl.
Oh my goodness.
And I don't know, it could be a Syeda Garrett thing. it just could be, you know, like you, association.
You have a Syeda Garrett like allergy.
You know, I absolutely do. I like Don't Look Any Further. Mm-hmm. But it's very minimal, Syeda. You know, it's
yeah,
just a little bit.
See, I hate that song.
What?
And it's because of Tupac.
Okay.
Because of Hit 'Em Up. I hated Hit 'Em Up so much, I was glad he got shot the second time. I didn't want him to die. I just...
Oh, okay. So there are very few things that I am not prepared for. I was not prepared for that. I consider myself to be pretty, I take whatever comes. That I was not prepared for. Wow.